I'd like to call this meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee to order at 6:30 p.m. Due notice having been posted. A roll call. Mr. Patrick?
Dave Patrick here.
Mr. Machado?
Here.
Mr. Souza?
Here.
Mrs. Gagliotti?
Here.
The chair is present. Mr. Kelly is presently at the high school with his daughter for the wellness night, but he hopes to be here by 7 o'clock for the tech presentation. And Ms. White could not be with us tonight due to a family matter. Also with us this evening are our superintendent of schools, Richard Medeiros, director of business and finance, Mark Tato, director of technology, Raymond Necres, and our recording secretary, Michelle Corson. I'd ask everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item on the agenda, the superintendent recommends the committee accept the secretary's report of open session minutes 1 and 2 for July 26, 2012. Have a motion.
So move.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliotti and seconded by Mr. Machado. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Second item on the agenda is the superintendent recommends the committee accept the secretary's report of executive session minutes of July 26, 2012. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mr. Patrick. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Unanimous. I'd like to move on the agenda to building committee because we have this evening a demonstration of the camera, and I'd like to recognize Michael McDonald, who is here with us this evening. He's the vice president and branch manager of the Somerset branch of Bank 5. We sincerely appreciate the contribution which Bank 5 made in underwriting the installation of the camera, which is an opportunity for the community to observe the progress of our construction project. So again, thank you very much.
Chairman Pearson, I just had some dental work, but I do want to say a few words.
Yes,
so yes. Please excuse me. I just can't say enough about four or five beliefs in giving back to the community, but I just can't say enough about, I think this is the 2-year anniversary of our building committee being together. And the hard work, you know, it's unimaginable, the countless hours. In the last 2 years, I calculated before I came here, it's well over 400 hours that they've spent together to make our community a better place to live in the future for our children. So, I mean, I want to thank the regional school board, administration, but mostly especially the building committee, because I don't think people imagine, and this is all for zero pay, that the members of what they do week after week and day after day to the project that's going to come into fruition in a couple of years. So again, this is just a little token of our appreciation, but for what you're doing, I just want to say thank you very much.
Thank you. It's great to have corporate citizens who are willing to support these efforts, and we really appreciate it. And Mr. Necres, would you like to tell us about the demonstration you have here this evening?
Ball works well, and it did about 30 seconds ago. Turn on. Off the Somerset Berkley Regional District site, which is www.sbregional.org, there's a link in the bottom right-hand corner. It's coming up. And that link is... If you go to this sbregional.org website, this is where all the pertinent information is for the district, but there's a live from SBR HS camera. What we're going to do on this, I talked to Mr. McDonald, and he's going to send me a logo for for Bank 5, and we're going to put that here, being such a generous sponsor for the camera. But if you just click on that, it takes you right to the camera. And right now, it's between the wireless here and everything else, it's kind of staying, but it does pan throughout the whole project. And we have at the high school a video server that will actually record what's going on. And I've talked to Mr. Sam Adams, the content coordinator of the technology department. He's going to get together with kids and make a stop motion. He's going to pull from that server pictures, see how it kind of moves. And he's going to make a stop motion of the whole project as the building's being built, like some of our other school districts in the state have done so. And I know Bank 5 was generous. I also want to do a shout out to Mr. Dave Gauthier that actually came in and helped set this up. And he's done a lot of work on the side, and I can't thank him enough. And Bank 5. Thank you.
Mr. Gauthier, I know the committee would like to thank you as well. I know you've been doing a lot for our technology, and well beyond assistance with installing the camera, so we really appreciate your help.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I think this is just to show us just another example of the community coming together. You know, we had a strong community presence when we did the groundbreaking. And this goes to show you another community presence with the businesses, local businesses, coming together just to show, you know, what a great effort that this is going to be, and a great, it's just a wonderful thing. And people will also be able to view it, I mean, live, so people don't have to drive by the site. They can go on the internet and view it, and it's live. As you can see, there's nobody there right now, but during the daytime, that site is very, very busy.
And we get much busier as the months go on. Well, I think we may return to the building committee update later, but let's return to our agenda until 7 o'clock. Well, the first item is the MASC Mass Joint Conference on November 7th through 10th. And I place that on the agenda just to try to get a reading from the committee as to what members might be interested in attending that conference, so we have an idea of how to allocate the very limited funds we have available for conferences of this kind. I don't know if people have had an opportunity yet to really focus on that, but sooner we can kind of get a handle on who might be planning to attend that.
I think, Mr. Chairman, I know Victor and I are interested in going, but I think that those the funds for that will more than likely just come out of the K-8 side. Just to let you know.
I was interested in going.
Patrick,
The Berkley School Committee will be sending somebody.
All right. The next item is inspection site visit for the Somerset Berkley Regional High School. I did send out an email on that issue. If people are aware that traditionally members of the school committee have toured the school building in advance of the school year, and tentatively scheduled that for tomorrow morning at 9:30. And I just wanted to get an indication of who might plan to attend. Certainly it is expected that the entire committee will be there. And I do plan to be there.
I'm going to make every effort, Mr. Chairman, to be there as well.
I don't think I can.
All right. I would just like to note that our Director of Curriculum, Dr. Brad Smith, has joined us. The next item on the agenda is a staffing update by the superintendent.
Thank you, Mr. Pierce. I just provided a short list. Some years that I've been here, it's been a lengthy list. We did not have a lot of retirements. In fact, in this instance, we didn't have any retirements for the region. So this simply reflects some resignations that have taken place, a maternity leave. And so you can see right now we have three of the five positions, but just to assure everyone, we start next week. I am meeting with the English Language Arts recommended candidate for the principal tomorrow afternoon. That resignation came in the middle of the month, and so I didn't add that name pending that piece, but you know, my initial read on that was certifications in line, and that should be another, so that should not be to be announced. We did have the loss of obviously the health teacher and athletic trainer, and I had a conversation with Dr. Mosley today who informed me he did have a recommended candidate for the health teacher position. The athletic trainer aspect of it is becoming a little bit more challenging, but we can still fill the health teacher position for classes for next week and may have to look at some other alternatives as it relates to the athletic trainer coverage. But that at least gives you a summary in relation to staffing issues at the regional high school, which puts us in good shape to start the year. There was one of the long-term substitute that's needed that we've taken right off the sub list. I didn't add that as a result of a medical leave to start the year, but we're confident that all the classes are covered, and we have those couple of TBAs that you might be nervous about a week or so out. We already sure you have projected names coming forward. I'll be meeting with one of the candidates tomorrow.
And with respect to the athletic trainer, are we planning on posting that on School Spring?
It is on, it's been on School Spring actually for the past week. It's a challenging area though for certification. We're actually the athletic trainer, the athletic director, Mr. Goodall and the principal are trying to pull together with MIA, other athletic directors of the schools to see if we can combine some efforts for services, and even if we need to contract out some services in relation to coverage for the requirements that are needed. But both positions, both the health teacher and the athletic trainer, are currently posted on our website and are on School Spring.
Is there a reason why it's a 0.8? And what is that? Does that mean they don't get certain benefits?
Yeah, it actually stems from historically that person had a limited schedule, was in fact the athletic trainer, and it never was funded as a full-time position. In fact, I think moving forward, I can see the high school administration seeing the need for a full-time health teacher, but that's really a result of what the position was previous and did not increase workload. We kept it at that piece. They can be separate. We posted them separately, quite frankly, which because you don't need to have the health teacher that you've hired or certified necessarily be the athletic trainer. So although obviously it's ideal in our circumstance, it's not required, and it looks like the candidates that we're getting, it won't be the same individual. But it's a challenge to bring in the athletic trainer. There are not a lot of certified people out there. A lot of schools are in that circumstance, and the contracted services are pretty significant. And I know Mr. Kudos had a discussion with Mr. Potato in relation to what that may be. We may be bringing a recommendation to you shortly if we don't come across. We've got some short-term solutions to upcoming, you know, fall sports games, but we might have to take a look at some other strategy and alternative to that, specifically to help the athletic trainer. But to answer your question, Jamie, it was something that's always been the case, and we haven't expanded that.
Next item on the agenda is an update from the Somerset and Berkley school committees.
Mr. Patrick.
Sure. Mostly two things. The school committee and the teachers union has come to an agreement on the new educator evaluation language, and it's now been sent to the state, waiting approval from the commissioner. And also, we're happy to say that we have extended the contract of Tom Lynch till 2018. you. Mr. Souza?
First and foremost, I think everyone has read over the past couple of days in the newspaper, the Wilbur principal has taken another job. Last night, with the direction of the superintendent and the support of the school committee, we have put interim principal Judy Richardson, who is the former principal over at Chase Street. We feel that that principal will be ideal person. She is very professional, very strong individual, and will move that school forward. The school inspections happened, and with the four elementary schools and the one middle school, we saw a number of upgrades, and the schools are all ready to go for the start of school. One big thing that we've done is we've done an electrical upgrade in many of the schools where it's going to save a substantial amount of money with new lighting, which is it's a white light, as you can see right here. It's completely different. You know, you can't really tell the difference unless you see the two different contrasts. And as I said last night, I saw it over at Chase. The two different rooms were side by side, and it's truly remarkable. It's half the lighting, and there's motion sensors that attach to every lighting. And like I said, it's going to be a substantial amount of savings on there. Mr. Machado, I don't know if we're missing anything.
No, that's fine. All right. Yep. Thank you. There are no questions. Next item is the food service RFP.
Mr. Chairman, at the request of the committee, we have finished the development of the RFP. It was sent electronically to everybody. We anticipate releasing the RFP on the 4th, which is Tuesday. We would have a pre-bid meeting on the 12th, where prospective bidders, respondents will come in and look at the facilities. The responses would be due on October 5th, which would make available to the two committees either October 11th or October 18th. The committee scheduled meetings for a joint meeting and presentations by the respondents. At that point, the committees could either entertain a motion after the presentations, or there is currently a scheduled meeting, joint meeting on November 1st, which would make it possible for the committees to get together and make a decision then as well. So there'd be two possibilities for the committees to get together and make a decision. We would ask that they go no later than November 1st again. The 2-month lead time is extremely tight to get this thing going, if the committees were to decide to go forward with a food service management company. The only other point I wanted to make is the email I sent. It kind of explained a little bit more about the employee clause, and regarding the region, there are four employees that are members of the union. There's a total of seven between the two districts. Out of the 28 members, only seven are working enough hours to be eligible for union membership.
Does that mean that there are only seven that are eligible for membership in the Bristol County Retirement Plan?
Yes, sir. And as a result, the language in the contract states, should a union position become available, the districts would be responsible for filling those positions.
Are there any questions?
I was wondering, other than the dates, what were the major changes in
there? There were no major changes. I added a bunch of pages that had to do with further restrictions, quality of food, nature of the response. There are legal parameters that the state requires that the response is confirmed to, conform to it. Those were explicitly stated in the contract now, as opposed to not being there. But other than that, the substance of the report requested action.
language with respect to current employees is at page 19, paragraphs H and I, and it says that all current hourly employees will remain employees of the district, and all new hourly employees for current union positions that are vacated will be hired by the district under the provisions of the existing collective bargaining.
Yes, sir.
And it also provides that the food service director, who presumably would be in charge, is subject to the final approval of the district.
For assignment. Yes.
Right. So I would ask for a motion to authorize the Director of Business and Finance to issue this request for proposals.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Souza and seconded by Mrs. Gagliotti. Is there any further discussion? Discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Right, unanimous. Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to take a very brief break to allow our presenters to set up, and we'll hopefully be back at 7 o'clock to begin the presentation.
Thank you.
All right, I would like to call our meeting back to order. As everyone knows, we have scheduled at 7 o'clock a presentation by TechEdge of their technology assessment. And so I would like to turn the floor over to the principals of TechEdge, Marsha Kaplan and Steve Kelly, for their presentation on their report.
Hey, good evening, everybody. We're really happy to be here. This is the end of the first phase of the project. It's a two-phase project. And we have about five extra packets if people are interested. The packet contains a PowerPoint presentation and the executive summary from the report. So feel free to read it once. Okay. Lunch taken and great.
Some of you may have had a chance to read it. This is the technology findings and recommendations document that we'll be going over today. It's got a lot more detail than we'll have time to present today.
About 144
pages. Yeah, we're going to try to keep it at a fairly high level, but if there are any areas you want to dig down into, you know, this is your opportunity.
And also, I'm impressed that in the summertime so many people have turned out for this, and what we're hoping to do here is to give you some concrete steps to go forward while we're in the process of developing the technology plan to really generate enthusiasm and excitement.
This is briefly what we're going to be doing today. I'm not going to read all the bullets. You can see what's happening. But we're just going to go over the whole process that we went through to get where we are, the major findings and recommendations and next steps.
And if people have questions as we're going through the presentation, please feel free to stop us to ask, and we'll have time for questions at the end as well.
Okay. So these are the project goals that were part of the RFP on which we responded. Again, you can read it, but the basic idea is you're getting a new high school, and you've got an old building you're going to be in for the next couple of years. The issue is, what do you do in the old high school for the next couple of years to get you ready for a real modern, state-of-the-art, high-technology school that's being built? And this is kind of where we came in, want to try to show ideas of what's going on. It's two phases. One is we did the findings and recommendations for today. That is going to lay the groundwork for the comprehensive technology plan. So in a way, this is kind of a checkpoint. We're kind of trying to communicate to you some areas we think the tech plan should go in, and we're really looking for some feedback that, yeah, that's good or acceptable, or don't you dare do that, and you know, we'll kind of adjust to it. we did a lot of stuff in the needs assessment. Marshall will go over that this in more detail in terms of what we did. But where we are now is we're right at the end of the report, giving the findings and recommendation presentation. That's what we're doing today. The next step after this, we'll finalize the report based on all the comments that have come back, and we have had some. We will then develop the technology master plan, five-year master plan, with a one-year action plan of what you should be doing over the next year, budget projections, and a process for monitoring the implementation of it so you can make any fine-tuned adjustments to it.
Because 5 years is a long time in the world of technology.
You want to have a little methodology.
Right. And we're going to go through the methodology very quickly.
There's no good place.
Yeah, I know. We use both qualitative and quantitative methods. So there were surveys. Then we had in-depth open-ended interviews, three surveys, documentation review, as well as site observation. And what we really tried to do is triangulate the data, get data from three or more sources. And so as you can see, 12 stakeholder interviews, 7 focus groups, and I won't go through, the document actually lists out all of the parties, so I won't go through, I have it in my notes, but I won't go through it. At least 40 documents reviewed, including best practices, and there'll be more, I'm sure. 3 surveys, and looking at the current building site. Now, we've gotten feedback from approximately 300 people. This is phenomenal, especially for an organization of your size. And I just want to point out that the staff survey, there was at least 65% of the staff responded, which Steve and I were talking about on the way down is almost unheard of. So to have that kind of response rate. So thank you, this is just great. So the first thing we want to talk about are your accomplishments, and we may have missed some. But when we started looking at everything you've accomplished in a couple of years, we were really amazed and so impressed. I mean, you've regionalized, you have a new school committee, you're building a new building while you're trying to maintain the infrastructure in the current building. You've gone through NEAS accreditation, which is such a labor, I don't have to tell you what a labor-intensive process that is. You have new administrators. And now you're making the commitment to address some of the serious technology challenges in the new building. I mean, in the current building, while the technology subcommittee for the new building is working on the technology for that building. So we also have challenges, and none of these are a surprise. Right now, schools across the country, and especially in Massachusetts, financial constraints. You've been under severe financial constraints. Accountability pressures. I don't need to really belabor that. We know what they are. And anybody who's done EPIMS and SIMS from the tech department know about the increased data reporting requirements. The good news is it's going to be easier in the near future with something we'll talk about in a bit. But right now it's very labor intensive. And now there's a common core. People in the curriculum department and the curriculum coordinators know about that. And now there's a requirement to embed 21st century skills into the common core. And then just when we thought we had MCAS down, there's going to be the PARC assessment, which is an online assessment, going to be assessing the common core, and that comes in 2014-2015 school year. So you're going to need to have the infrastructure. You'll be in the new building by then, which is the good news. And technology changes. I mean, turn around, I have an iPad 3, it's going to be obsolete, you know, in the next couple of years, if that. So there's a lot of challenges here. And for both the accomplishments and the challenges, did we miss anything that people think we should have captured? Oh, I'm sorry, I'll speak. I'm sorry, I'm cold. Did we miss any accomplishments or challenges that you think we didn't capture here? Okay. So, now, this is really the meat. The key findings, the recommendations, and then the last part, we're going to go with how we're going to phase, we recommend that things get phased in. So the areas that we reviewed, there were 10 areas. 9 of the areas had findings and recommendations. The first area really looked at the national and state initiatives that impact what you're doing in the classroom and in the school. And I think everybody's familiar with most of those initiatives. We talked a little bit about the new assessment. Of course, there's always No Child Left Behind with MCAS, and we've been moving from AYP to accountability measures. There's the new teacher assessment that assessment instrument that's being used. There's STEM, there's the technology literacy standards, there's always data integration, schools interoperability framework, which I saw somebody shaking their head for EPIMS and SIMS. It should make within the next couple of years. If you have the student system that is compliant with SIF, it should make your life a lot easier. I just want to make sure. Oh, and Edwin. Edwin's the new teaching and learning system that the state is implementing. I don't know where, I still haven't figured out the name, but I'm sure we'll figure that out. And Edwin is supposed to have things like curriculum tools, be able to do formative assessments, a lot of information, more reporting about students. Let's see if I missed anything. Oh, digital resources, that's important. In the second area, which I think is chapter 3, we really look at all the strategies to deliver instruction, curriculum technology integration. And there has been a lot of data from the surveys and focus groups and interviews that inform that chapter. In bullet 3, learning environments, we talk about all of your technology resources, including even looking at virtual learning. But we looked at your computer inventory. Somebody was kind enough to send us an update. We're updating that with, I think, social studies had other equipment that we needed to update. And what else? Missing computers, video, projectors, smart boards. And then under the network infrastructure, internet, local area network, wide area network, and wireless is discussed in that area. And then security and safety, both physical and online security and safety are dealt with in that chapter. Okay, administrative, academic, and accountability apps. Here we look at your student information system, and we've gotten a lot of feedback about MMS. So we look at that. We're looking at your special ed system that you have. Any kind of formative assessment or thoughts about formative assessment here would go in here. Let's see if I missed anything that's key in that area. Oh, your library system and a discussion about cloud computing. And then in operating principles and practices, technology policies, procedures, standards for technology, it's really critical to take a look at the acceptable use policy. Some districts are moving to bring your own device, so we'll look at policies for districts that are already implementing bring your own device and see if it's something that's a fit here. And of course, we're going to look to you to see if this is something that you're interested in. And of course, the network infrastructure has to be set up so that it's safe and secure. And then the technology staffing and service delivery, we're looking at the staffing. As we can tell you, and when we get to the findings, you have 3 people doing a heroic job and you're understaffed. And then technology expenditures and funding, we're looking at things like E-rate and grants. And there is a grant. Well, first of all, I'll just quickly give you a highlight of E-rate. Are most people familiar with it? Okay, then I won't waste time doing that. People are familiar. There is a grant out which we would be very happy to help you with. It is due in the middle of September, and it's from the state, and it could help you defray the cost or possibly pay for a new student system should you decide to do it. And it would be, because it's looking at collaboration as well as regionalization, it might be something that you, if you decide that MMS is not the way to go, you could do it with the other 2 school districts and possibly get much of it paid for through the grant. And they are really looking at collaboration and regionalization. Those are the 2 key things. So they could be a really good story to tell if that's something that you're interested in. And then monitoring and evaluation, we have got a 5-year plan. It's going to change, so it's a process for updating the plan. Okay. So, key findings. There's no formal structure in place to oversee tech planning and implementation. This is in the old building. We know that there's a structure in place for your new construction. So this is something that you really need to address right away. And we have thoughts and recommendations on how to do that. People across the board complained that the infrastructure, the internet was slow, the technology was unreliable. And there's been a debate, an ongoing debate between Mac versus PC. There's an ongoing debate everywhere between Mac versus PC, but we have to come to some agreement on how to go forward with that. And as I mentioned, we don't have enough support staff. And finally, financial constraints have seriously contributed to the shortage of investment in technology. However, you're really to be tremendously commended because you made a decision, conscious decision, to keep class size down and to keep teaching staff at the same level. And it's really unusual to see a union and school committees agree to something like this. So we really respect you all for that, and it was a hard choice, I'm sure. And so now you're moving in the direction of technology. So, some of the key findings, curriculum coordinators and curriculum director are considering purchasing scanners for common assessments in both ELA and math, and we have some recommendations for that. And there may be a better way to go and much more cost effective, if not free. We'll get to that in the recommendations. Based on input from survey data as well as interviews and focus groups, we feel that many of the educators, even if they felt that they were really good at technology, they felt that they did not have sufficient expertise to really do an adequate job of curriculum technology integration. Now, certain areas are really, it's no surprise, the STEM areas, science, technology, engineering, and math, really felt very comfortable, and some of the other areas are having a problem. I mean, for example, you don't have a language lab in this school. You will in the new building, which is great, but that's an issue we might need to address in the current infrastructure. The need for professional development in curriculum technology integration, this is already being addressed. We received a very detailed email from the curriculum director outlining all of the plans in place for this coming school year for professional development. We will certainly have suggestions for other areas in the report. We'll go into more detail on some of the things we think you can do. And then we have the sense, now we're not going to debate whether or not MMS is the best system in the world, but we don't think that you're using it right now to its full potential. And we think that you may want to have a demo right away from the rep. You are not, for example, there's a flag that flags special education. That flag is not turned on. You are not inputting MCAS data. You're not MCAS, PSATs, SATs. I don't know if there are other things that we're missing, but those are some of the things that are not being input at the moment that could be. And I think that are really important. Okay. So, before we move to the recommendations, which is the first section, because these are the findings, and of course you jumped ahead, but we're trying to move fast, but we want to spend a little time. In terms of the findings, any questions, any comments that people feel, were things stated correctly here? Did we miss something that's really huge?
Well, just the MMS system, you said it wasn't used to its full potential. I said, well, I guess we can't debate that right now, but did you find that the system that we're using isn't being used its full potential, or that the one we're using can't live up to its current potential?
I can, we had the MMS rep come in a few months ago and talk to a select few of the administrators and kind of point out all the features that aren't being used. So I believe if we bring the rep in again, maybe have content coordinators, some teachers, staff again, and then provide professional development to to see what can be used, I think you can have a fairer picture and you'll be able to answer that. It's a state-approved vendor, like all the other vendors, and they have certain requirements that they have to meet before they can sell their product. So.
And it's been moved to the cloud already, or off-site, so now it's not going down?
It's been on the cloud for a few years. I was running a server. That server was dying, so we made a decision to shift it off-site. As we said, there's only three people in my department.
And when we talk, when we get into the recommendations, we have some other recommendations about how to proceed with student, with the student information system, because MMS is just one of a number of newer systems out there, and there may be systems to look at that are not on the state vendor list that may have more modern features. So I think that you need to have an informed, you know, you need to really look at all, well, Steve will do it. You don't want me to do it?
No, okay. I'm not trying to debate whether to address it now or address it.
Oh, well, let's just address it now, so we're talking about it. Do you want
to? No, I think the first thing that needs to be done is for you guys to see what's available out there publicly. You know, invite in several different vendors. It's been a while since the state did its last thorough evaluation of vendors. And there's been a sea change in reporting requirements and approaches since then. New vendors have come on the scene. So going strictly off the existing vendor list may not be the best thing, but I think it's important for you to see what are some of the capabilities of the system. And then once you see that, figure out what of all those things you really value, what's really important to you. And if MMS can do those things, great, end of story. If you feel MMS can't do that, then we're recommending that you go out for a competitive bid and in a formal process get proposals from vendors. We strongly recommend you demo those things. Many of the vendors will give you logins, so you can log into their system and play around with it and explore, and then see who comes up with the best price.
Well, and you also want to make sure that each of the constituents has a list of required features, and that is something that you should be using as your guide as you go through. First, you want to just see what's there. Then once you see what's there, then you come back with a list of specifications that you want. And if MMS can meet it, great. It may need upgrading to something, but if not, then you may seriously consider.
So are you saying that MMS is not meeting our needs?
People do not feel that it's meeting your needs now, but what we're saying is there are features that are not being used that are in the current system. So that's something you need to look at, the features that are not being used, ease of use, to see if it meets your needs. So we are recommending a two-part approach here. One, looking at what's in the existing system, whether or not you have to pay for some of the additional features or whether or not it's part of the package that you have now.
I did a transition from Redeker to Aspen. So I understand what you're saying about
changing student systems.
Is no joke. And especially if you have a user base who already can't exercise the system you have.
We weren't able to clearly identify whether it's training issues, whether there hasn't been a lot of rapport between the company and the people in the district to see all these vendors are all the time putting out new features.
Yes.
So the system you started off with is not the system that's there now.
Right.
And if you're just using what you had then, they've put in a whole series of new things.
Right, but that's shame on us.
Yes, we're not saying throw MMS out per se. We're saying, look at it, see if it's something that you feel can meet your needs. It may need some augmentation, it may need some other modules, it may need training, it, you know,
it does.
Wide variety of things. But also, I think it would behoove you to look at other systems as well to see what's out there.
Again, you'll see some wonderful things. The question is, what's the ramp to get there?
Well, and that's why, if you're going to do this, we recommend you do it before you move into the new building, that this is something that should be done ahead of time. And also a phased-in approach.
Okay. Yeah, some of the things we'll get to later on has to do with sequencing. What do we do first? What do we do second? And what we've tried to do is spread out kind of what you would do. So you'd want to get comfortable with either an enhanced MMS or another student system next year before you go into a brand new building.
I don't want to have this turn into a discussion as to whether we should change our student reporting system. We understand some issues have been identified and we need to look at this, but we have a lot of other recommendations that we should go through.
Absolutely. But you're right.
The one key finding I wanted to point out that I think is missing is the power issues or lack thereof in the classrooms throughout the current high school. We have classrooms with one plug or two plugs that are pretty much daisy chained into other classrooms. So if you add more devices, you can pop the circuit. So
we'll stress that. You're right. It's the power is limited. The old building, very much so. So the first thing we were talking about is to establish a planning committee for technology for dealing with the old building. You've got one for the new building, and it's probably wise to have some cross membership between those two. So each of you kind of know what's going on, but that'll help figure out what to do over the next 2 years.
And that the principal should be, or his designee should be chair of that committee.
The second is to do with the PC Macintosh thing. We talk to many people. Usually it's the issue has been, should we be all Macs or all PCs? We talk to a lot of people in different curriculum areas, and some of them are saying, if we go to Macs, you know, I'm leaving. It doesn't have the software we need to run our stuff. And then we also talk to other people and say, if you go all PC and you don't allow any Macs in here, the software we need for our students doesn't run on the PCs, or it's not available on that. It doesn't work with our curriculum. So what we're recommending is that the high school have a mixture of Macs and PCs that work as well together as is possible. And these days, they work very well together. So for example, you might go to the science and engineering or math or arts or some of the other disciplines and say, what do you feel you need for your students? And then other areas may be, well, whatever is most popular, whatever the kids have at home, etc. But we feel it should be based on the curriculum, not someone saying, you got to do this or that.
No.
There's some support issues we'll get to in a second. It's more difficult to support two different platforms. But we feel in terms of the infrastructure in the new school and to a large extent in the old school can be made to support both Macs and PCs very well. So you could have one user and password to use for either Macs or PCs. You log in, you've got your same files, no matter whether you log in from a PC or a Mac. You can use the software on that computer, the special curriculum software that's kind of custom tailored for you. And in terms of the infrastructure, there are ways of doing it, and as we get into the implementation stage, we'll highlight how that might be done. But it's a pretty standard way of doing things these days. And the other one is to migrate from Novell NetWare, which is at the end of its life, into a combination of Windows and Macintosh servers. The state, a couple of years ago, came up with new technology literacy standards and expectations. They're pretty good, and they're ones that I think you should be looking at to incorporate into your curriculum as well. But also, the issue that Marcia was talking about earlier, about you've got a few people who might know a lot about technology and how to integrate it into the curriculum, into their instructional plans, but a lot of them don't. So we think having teachers being mentors to other teachers is a very good model. It works well in other schools. We ask in the survey if teachers would be willing to spend time mentoring other teachers to incorporate technology into their curriculum, and had a very overwhelmingly positive response to that. The professional development plan, as Marcia mentioned earlier, that's already underway. It's kind of like we weren't the only people in the world who realized that was needed. You know, the district did too, and they're already taking steps to deal with that.
And we will add some suggestions in the plan as well.
Yeah, can I just make a brief comment on that? You know, one of the important clarifications that I think needs to be underscored, I think that a major focus at the high school has been the shift in English language arts and mathematics curriculum frameworks, which, as you know, embed the Common Core standards. And I think within these frameworks, which has been a professional development priority, I want to be clear about that.
Yes.
And just in terms of curriculum review and revision, which is a multi-year plan and a cycle, which focuses on curriculum review and revision. And within those frameworks, which has been a professional development priority here in the district, certainly at the high school in terms of the work we've done in English language arts and mathematics, I think it's important to underscore that within the revised frameworks, which embed the Common Core standards, embed the 21st century skills.
Yes.
But I just want to make that clarification in terms of the work that we have forecasted out to 2014, which, because you can't separate the PD from the curriculum review and revision piece. I just want to make that clarification.
I thoroughly agree. And some of the assessments that some of the teachers would like to have to do in math and English language arts to try to make sure that the kids are up to the right levels. They were talking about getting some scanners to be able to bubble sheet answers in and score it. We feel that there are right now some free and low-cost online tools that allow you to do that. One that we've seen a lot of success with is one out of WPI called Assessments.
Oh, Assessments.
Assessments. Sorry, I can never get that right.
It's
great. A free software for Massachusetts schools. And it allows you to embed multimedia in the online assessment. So, for example, you could ask the students to review a short course in con on quadratic equations, and then come back and see how well the child understands what he's just seen, and to be able to guide instruction that way. So we think that's the way to go there. The state is also in their EdWin program. going to have similar capabilities, but that's something that the state's planning on phasing in at the end of this year, over the next year and a half. So if you need to move faster.
You could get an assistance account tomorrow, tonight.
I just wanted to clarify something from, I'm the math content coordinator at the high school, and I was reading just the sentence on the scanners for like English and math. I just want to clarify the reason my department wanted scanners was to be able to get some of our worksheets online in terms of like having a scanner, in terms of the like having the copy machine be able to be a scanner, so that way we could have them. So if a student was absent, for example, we could post that to a website and have students access work and worksheets like that, because I just want to be clear, we don't want to give bubble sheet tests. We might want to prepare them for like the park exam, taking online assessments, but we don't want to go to like multiple, we want open-ended
responses. I see, it's just so...
I just wanted to clarify, just to make sure.
Okay, great, thank you.
It's just so you don't have to Xerox the papers all the time.
Right, like for students, like for absent students who need to check their work online, we wanted to have that capability, but not necessarily for like bubble sheet exams.
Okay.
Can I just ask you a question? Do you have copiers have the capability of doing emailing? When you scan the paper, the emails, you now have a digital copy, you have a scanned copy. So you don't need the scanner, you can just upload that. Is that set up?
Not at all, in some of them.
Okay, because that would, then you wouldn't need a scanner if you have that.
We're going out new scanners that are networks.
Okay, the next section here is on staffing. As we've mentioned before, and I think this is based on the surveys of everybody as well as conversations, there are three technology staff people who are supporting all of the Somerset public school system as well as the high school. And that's just a lot of things to be responsible for. They're responsible for more than what you would, that many people would think. Typically, if you think of IT, you think of repairing machines, fixing things that are broke, etc. But the IT staff actually have broader things they're responsible for doing that takes them away from these other things that you might want them to do. So we've come up with a kind of a different approach for supporting primarily the high school, which is what our job was, is to focus on the high school. We're suggesting that you hire one IT physician that be very good at dealing with the network, wireless, switches, servers, those type of infrastructure elements. And that person would report to the principal. Also important is that the person start at 7 o'clock in the morning. We heard that loud and clear, primarily from, well, many of the teachers and administrators, is they don't have any technology support when schools opens. So this is needed to address that. The student state reporting right now, every time, several times a year, you have to upload material to the state website. It goes through an evaluation process there to check it to see if it's valid. And if it's not valid, it spits it out and has you figure out what should the right codes be, why do you have these duplicate people, all sorts of issues that might occur. That's an admirable job, and the tech support staff are doing that now. But we think for the high school, it would be better for the state reporting to go to the scheduling office's responsibility for that, for all information about students, and the state staff reporting to the personnel function.
Whoever does class scheduling and also registers students.
You reference scheduling and guidance office.
We weren't quite sure who else should be the right person. The guidance
seems to have a fair amount of supervision of that now.
I was just asking definition-wise, what did you find as a scheduling office?
It was guidance.
Well, one of the DOE benchmarks by 2015 is for districts to have a data person in place. So I would think that data person would do the data job.
Well, hopefully by then we'll have SIF really operating and it will be seamless, hopefully. That would be wonderful.
But there's the data warehouse. We had a huge training today, teachers writing reports. One of the comments the trainer made is, if you need a special report, go to the IT guys and they'll write it for you. And then she went on to say
I know.
So, and she goes, that would take up to like 80 hours to write these reports to get the student data mined. That would be the data person, too. I mean, that's where you would go. It wouldn't be me or my Mark Kuchar in the back room who fix networks and computers and switches and printers and coffee pots and everything else. But I don't think, say, Diane Paskowski in the scheduling office would be writing, or she can, but she's a part-time person. I respect what you say, but I think having a chain of command and a IT department is an IT department. To mix it to the scheduling, have people reporting to, okay, you're going to go report to this person, don't go talk to this person. It's a breakup of a department and a function that I don't think in the long run is survivable to.
I may not be understanding the point. You're saying we need PIMS and SIMS with the IT department?
Well, to the data person that the DOE has a benchmark for all school departments to have. That would be that job. That data person would fall under the IT department. I think naturally, only because they're using all the technology to get it done. Or if it's a central office, because we have two districts, and although we are separate, at certain points, we're one. And doing the data and doing have two separate reports and people entering data in one district one way, another district another, is once you bring the kids up from eighth grade to the high school, you don't have that continuity in the data fields, it's going to crash in that.
And I think that's part of the reason why we're saying that needs to be into the departments that really know that data so they can make sure the data is correct. But let's move on. In terms of the support, we see the library media specialist who already has had their job redefined once, take a role in helping with the curriculum technology integration.
Well, she's doing a greater role.
Yes, greater role.
An expanded
yes.
role.
Yeah. And some of the things that's worked out very well in some districts is giving teachers time from their schedule to be able to support other teachers who may have problems. It's often put in terms of buying time or getting a period that is freed up for that teacher so they can spend time assisting other teachers as a way of trying to support the end user part of the system. And also having students have a elective course so students can help learn how to support technology. It's a good thing for the kids, and I think it'll be a good thing for the school as well to have responsible kids able to talk to adults, helping them out. I think it's some good models there. Finally, in this model, is it's kind of like fire and police. If there's a huge fire someplace, you call on your neighboring towns to help you put out the fire. You try to be self-sufficient most of the time, but there are times you need help. And I think there's some ways where the tech support in the high school could help out Somerville Public, Somerset Public Schools, and vice versa. You know, there'll be times when a lot of stuff needs to be done, and there just isn't manpower to do it here.
We're both good pair here. Okay, and jump in where you need to. So sequencing activities. First of all, the first thing that we really believe that you need to do is convene this task force. I think that is an immediate next step. And after that is advertising for this IT position. And we have provided just a recommended job description for this position that Steve just described. And then, of course, reconcile this platform issue. And these are kind of immediate next steps. This should be done in the next couple of months, figuring out who needs what, and then sitting down and figuring out is it feasible. We're doing the technology plan. We're going to be completing the plan in the fall. And then you're going to have to talk about this. This is your area, the Golden Triangle.
This is more of a technique to be able to integrate Macs and PCs together so they function together. So there's one, it's almost like a chart of accounts, there's one master list of all the users and the responsibilities of what they can get to. There's special additional fields that the Macs have, and that's why you need the Mac server in there. But the main management of the system would be from the Windows side. And once you have that Active Directory, it gives a lot of capabilities if you start going to cloud computing. What you'd like, if you want to use Microsoft tools or Google tools or who's ever, to be able to use the same user and password you use on your local system, use that on the cloud. If you change the password on your local system, you'll have to use the new one on the cloud system. And most of the major systems support what's this Active Directory, this directory of all the different users and their passwords and what they can do and what they can't do.
So the next set of activities, again this fall, are addressing and correcting the network issues in the old building. I mean, that's what came out loud and clear in our interviews and with a site visit. And then look at student information systems. We've talked about that already. We see that as something doing, defining the system requirements this fall. And then if MMS is really not what you think you need, and going out to bid and starting to implement in the spring. And we're not minimizing, we agree, we know what the ramp up time is like. So there's going to be additional support needed to convert over to a new system if you do, and then train.
And you want to bring up the grant thing again?
This grant could be something that could fund either the upgrade for MMS or at least partially fund the upgrade for MMS or a new system.
Not only for the high school, but for
the districts.
The two districts that feed it.
What's the name of the grant?
It's on the DESE website. It's collaboration,
it's
communication.
Under the finance,
We could send out the actual name of the grant. We'll get the information out to you. It's collaboration, communication, regionalization, technology grants.
It's intended to try to support regionalization,
which you've done.
Collaboration, which you've done, and so you can have a common student system throughout all the feeder districts. It's trying to encourage that. So if you want to upgrade it or go to another one, then that's an opportunity to go for it.
You understand we're all on MMS now?
Yes.
We're all
on MMS now.
Well, that was the point. Since you're all on MMS, if what the grant is due in a few weeks, but you could put in there that you're either going to upgrade MMS or go to a new system, then it would be all that everybody would go to the new system.
But we have no function. Work over Berkley, they're on MMS too, so we bring the kids up. very seamless.
But I know, and the point of the grant is, you would have, if the other districts are interested, only if they're interested in it, you'd all three districts would go in on the grant. It would be three districts going into the grant. If there's interest in the other districts. And I think the only way to get the grant is to have the interest. But it could be to upgrade MMS for the three districts. I mean, it's worth taking a shot at it, that's all.
I think that grant program may have been in effect for a few years, and I think we actually applied for a grant under that program and it was denied. But that doesn't mean we can't revisit it with a new idea. I think we're aware of the program, so we should look at it and see if there's an avenue to follow.
The other thing is, right now you've got a lot of capabilities that you're using. Many of the classroom sites use a website. Email is on a separate system. Document editing, storage. You can't get to the files here from home. And we feel that if you look at a couple of options for using the web to provide in a common user interface, a common logon, where you could get all the things really at the top of here. And we see two things right now that might be able to give that: Google Apps for Education and Microsoft's just released Cloud 365 for Education. You can look at Apple's iCloud, but I don't think it gives quite the same range of services as the others do. But this would allow you to have, again, the common logon for your local system, for the web at home, access the same files from home as from school. One of the things with Cloud 365 is that allows you to use some of the newer versions of Microsoft Office for the web. So there's a web version of Microsoft Office. There's also a lower cost option if you want to use it, but you can use the web one for free. The benefits of both of these is they're free. I mean, and it allows you to manage. Both of these packages here have a great deal of control. So if you're worried about, if you don't want your students to have email, you can block them. If you don't want them to be able to chat, you can block them. Or if you want them to, allow them to use it. This is, you know, we're just saying these are some things you should be looking into as a way of moving forward. And we feel that this will also help reduce support cost because it consolidates a lot of the work into one place, and so much of the management in terms of synchronization of users, passwords, files can be done automatically. You don't need someone from tech support to be refreshing all the user accounts all the time. It just happens automatically. So those are some of the ways we think that all of the stuff you're doing in instruction can be put into one area that will provide a lot of the services that you're now picking up at individual websites. And we think that one of the things we talked about from the very beginning was, is there some things you could do in the old building that you could take to the new building that would give you immediate benefits in the old building but still be usable in the new? And the areas that we feel are best able to do that would be switches and wireless access points that are currently planned for the new building. Those could be put into the existing high school now. There's some work that needs to be done
we're thinking that that would probably be implemented next summer. There's some planning and procurement that needs to go on ahead of time. And also the servers that we talked about earlier, those are also things that could be put in the old building and then easily moved to the other. There would be some money that you would have to pay extra. And I try to address that in one of the sheets I put into the board members packet. For example, putting the wireless access points throughout the building, there's usually a little mounting bracket. You may need a different mounting bracket in your old building than you do in the new one. So you may need to have a new mounting bracket and someone to mount it. But most of the work is very transferable between the two.
And maybe I should have mentioned this in the beginning, is what we were thinking is that this, if you look at it in big terms, you'd like to be able to go into the new building being able to take advantage of as much as possible when you get there. But you need some learning. You need to start doing things in different ways. So we were conceptualizing a lot of this coming year as a planning and getting ready to do stuff, with the summer months as the time you start putting the new stuff in, and then a subset of what you'll be having in the new school will then be ready for you a year from now, so that you can work within your classrooms. And then when you get to the new school, don't have as much to learn all at once.
Do you know if there's any consideration on buying computer equipment now on the budget of the new school? Because that's all ready, and a lot of the switches and everything are part of the bid process of building a new school. That's already out. And I do know I talked to AA3 architects, and they said that you can't buy anything now and use it and put it back in
what I was thinking of as you were talking about this piece is that when I met with some other districts who have undertaken a building project, they actually looked at working with existing vendors that may be providing those services in the new building to actually trial out that those switches within their existing building, if that's possible. And I think it was in Sutton School District who did it for a period of time so that they could test that out and see, and it was at relatively no charge. But I think, Ray, what we need to do is kind of look at what those options are and how other districts have maybe done that so that they can.
And we can talk to Ted, the superintendent. Yeah.
I'd love to leverage everything, but when I talked to AI3, they said the switches for the new school will be actually put in and programmed in the spring, early spring of 14. So there'll be a point from early spring of 14 to the end of that school year where we're going to pull the switches out of it with this.
Well, I think we understand the logistical issues, and that's something for the task force to explore. Obviously, we're not going to buy a whole set of switches or use for 1 year if they're not transferable to the new building. So that's a matter of exploring and talking with the MSBA and all of those kinds of issues. So it would be great if it could be done, but it may not be possible. We just have to look at it.
We'll check and see how it's done.
What we've done lately, and I've got Mr. Gauthier here, and I don't want to sound like I'm taking up the floor. Dave's given me some help lately on VLANing, which I've been planning on doing for about a year now, the current high school. Dave, can you give us just a little overview of what we did recently to help?
Well, I can wait until, you want to wait until they finish, or I can?
Okay. It's parts.
Well, one of the things that happened, and some people may know or may not know, that I've helped on with some other stuff at some of the other facilities, some needs that they had and some problems that have come up. Basically, well laid out, I agree. Active Directory is definitely the way to go. I mean, I work for most of the major medical facilities from here to Kalamazoo. A lot of people in Active Directory, you know, you're right, NetWare, it is going away. But, you know, it's what we have and it's what we've, you know, what we've had to deal with. And you're correct, the biggest problem in the high school has been, it's an infrastructure problem. A lot of it's legacy, and a lot of it comes from not having enough people, and not having enough, you know, funding, and not having enough people. So, you know, with working with the other stuff, I've been working with Ray since last summer, and, you know, we've been implementing Wi-Fi technology in the other schools. So he asked me to go in and help him. And like I said, just to give you an example, I've done, you know, VLAN layouts for up to 2,000, you know, 2,000 to 3,000 VLANs. Monitored, you know, broadcasted across, you know, all over New England, across California, stuff like that. So what I did was, this is a layout, basically, of, and again, this doesn't affect anything that you have there. It just addresses the infrastructure piece, because we really couldn't wait. We can't have, I couldn't see, after talking to Ray and, you know, talking to some other people, we couldn't really wait until 2013 or 2014. Because by the time you get into procurement, by the time everything happens, by the time you get the stuff all laid out, you got a year before the new school opens. And then, you know, just looking at this, I know there are some complications when you try to go from one funding source to another. It's a little different in our industry. You just pick the funding source and move it over. In your industry, it's a little bit different. When I say industry, right, industry of education. So what we've actually done at this point, and I got a few of these, if you guys want to just hold them to take a look at them. I don't have enough for everybody. What we did was we just identified, and this is just the infrastructure portion. Anybody over here want? Okay.
I just have a quick question. When you say we, what do you mean?
Well, I say we. My company came in and we did it, and I actually worked, you know, with Ray. To actually go out and take a look at what the specific infrastructure problem was within the high school so we could get it ready when school opened for the, you know, beginning of the year. So,
what is that what they did though? I mean, did you do the same
thing? No. It's a little bit different, I went into the mechanical nuts and bolts of it to actually take a look and see what physically is the problem with the wires. Do we have a wiring problem? Because you had issues. There were issues and they've been known for quite a period of time, okay? So what we did was we identified where exactly the problems were, and what the distances were on the cables to what we call a central core switch, okay? And what we did was we took a look and we laid out the latency. And this is what we do for the hospitals. This is what we do, you know, for other people. Because you were having network problems, you had definitely had internet speed issues. When I took a look at this in the beginning, we were sitting at about, you know, 2 to 3 meg maximum of download speed, and your upload speed was somewhere around a half a meg, you know, sometimes a meg, depending on what was going on. Had to do with the filters that were being used, so on and so forth, okay? What we did was we actually found out that the network was overextended by 300 meters in what we call a single layer. So it was one big network, which I'm sure that you saw, okay? What we did was basically we took a look at it, identified where the problems were, looked in the layout of wires that I'm sure you saw there, toned everything out, and actually went out and used some validator equipment from JDSU, and went out and utilized land scanning equipment, and basically analyzed the whole network to find out if there were bad cables, you know, what the distances were, so on and so forth. Once we did that, we found out where a couple of the problems were. We actually corrected them, built. If you look on here, I've got everything laid out based on, you know, IP. We figured out how many feet they were, and we designed the diagram and basically said, this is what we need to do to actually correct it, okay? We've actually corrected most of the problems already, okay? There's two sections left in the issues that we have. The people in the high school should be noticing already a difference in speed. Our download speed on the internet right now ranges on the wireless side from about 16 to 18 meg down and 6 to 8 meg up. And on the wired side, we're running 30 meg down and somewhat up of 10 meg up, which is almost a full bandwidth array. Because we kind of throttle things so we don't have all the bandwidth going, you know, to one section. And we also put it into a distribution device, which basically sits there. And you can actually increase your bandwidth now by basically going in and telling Comcast, give me more bandwidth, okay? You turn it up, it'll go faster. If you need to add more bandwidth, you can add a second line in, you can balance it. It'll go faster, okay? So we did that basically so that at this point, all the other stuff that you're talking about up there can just be implemented. And if you want to stick Macs on, you know, this network, you can. If you want to stick PCs on the network, you can. If you want to put access points on the network, in about another week or so, you'll be able to do that, okay? The only thing that's required at this point that we need to do, and we've committed to purchase and install it, okay? There's two sections of labs that actually need to be fiber because they're just too far. You've got the CAD lab down at 311, okay? That CAD lab is almost 500 feet away, sitting on a single Cat 6, okay? Too far. It's gotta be 100 meters or less. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go into the graphics lab and hop two six-strand fibers over, bring the layer down to 10 feet. It'll actually bring the network down to about 205 meters, okay? Which then the whole high school is within, you know, range, and we've broken it down into one, two, three, probably seven or eight VLANs. Already broken down, already running, already taken care of. My company has committed to put the necessary switches in to actually take care of it so that you can plug and be ready to go. So at that point, fixing the network within another 2 weeks is really a done issue. You can plug it in, it'll be hospital grade, you know, when I'm done. At that point, like I said, you can plug wireless in, you can pick whatever you want for wireless. Any of the software that you want to put in, you can decide. I mean, none of that stuff really has any effect on the network. Going forward with it, my reasoning was, you know, when I get in, I'm one of those people, I get in, I started to look at it while I was trying to help with, you know, some other stuff. I saw the need, and we just took care of it. You know, like I said, I got a lot out of the community, you know, growing up as a kid, time to give back. And, you know, basically the land portion of the network is done. And that doesn't mean you still can't, you know, sit there and analyze it and go through and, you know, do whatever else, you know, you want to do with it. But the basic core of the network is done. They actually had a Procurve 3500 layer 3 switch sitting there, totally PoE, you know, ready to go. Was being used, it was put in, and when I guess the company had originally come in to put it in, they went up and tried to separate, you know, and tie in the administrative network to the school network. And actually, I went in and took a look. It took me about 5 minutes to, you know, get in past the password, take a look at it, see what was going on. And they had everything bridged. So if you actually did, right, if you actually did a, you know what I'm talking about, if you actually did a scan of it, you would get this cross-layering of all these IPs.
I got that when I did.
Right. So what I did, if you look at it now, it's perfectly pure. It goes right down the line, and what you'll see is it goes out to one IP, basically that bridges out to the internet. Now that IP, you can tie as much bandwidth to it as you want, and my latency is down to 1 millisecond now on the network. Right.
And he also replaced the firewall, so that also is going to give you some better speed.
Yeah, we actually replaced that in June or July, but I needed to do the rest of the stuff to implement it. And like I said, I just wanted to help with a few other things, and I started doing one thing, did another. Next thing you know, I had the whole thing apart. And so that's basically, that part of it is basically gonna, it's ready. I mean, I've got two pieces of fiber to run. The network will be within range, and basically then you can do whatever, you know, else you need to do. And again, it was done mostly because, you know, of all the complaints that I've heard from everybody. I talk to a lot of people in town, and I've just been hearing, you know, more and more, it's slow, it's this, I can't get on the internet, we can't YouTube, we can't do this. And I don't really care. I mean, I have no preference. I have Macs, I have, you know, PCs, so I have zero preference on any of the stuff.
We do too.
Yeah, I don't care. I mean, you know, Google Apps, it's great. Yeah, the directory interface, it's great. You're right, Novell, it's going away. You know, there's no doubt about it. It's definitely, we gotta bet there's like 5 years. You know, 5 years, Novell will be gone. You know, it'll be something else, you know. core will be...
Or certainly NetWare will be gone.
Yeah, NetWare will be gone, but Novell will be implemented. I mean, they had their chance. Yeah, they could have sold they could have sold themselves to Microsoft for a ton of money, and they said no. So, you know, they're just another casualty.
So it sounds like you have already pleaded the address and correct network issues.
90%
sounds like it.
We've got
doing the testing out of the individual cables.
Yeah, and if you take a look at the back end of this,
the test results.
Yeah, and I'm sorry I didn't have time because I've got a lot of projects going on. I didn't have time to put the network diagram in a Visio. But if you take a look at the last pages, you'll see the JDSU detailed test results. Yep. Those are all the core cables, okay? With the distances and the you know, whether they were a pass or a fail. So, you know, and they're labeled.
I'm surprised 311 was working to the extent that she was.
Well, actually, to be honest with you, I'm surprised. Well, I'm actually surprised 311 was actually, you know, working. But what they did was they put a Cat 6 in there, which actually gave them the additional distance because. But it's it runs very slow. It's very slow in the CAD lab. But that's going to be replaced within a 2-week period. And the fiber actually showed up at the office in our warehouse this week one day. So I was going to try and actually get the fiber in before school opened, because if we do that, then we've decreased latency by probably a factor of 15 to 20, you know, 20 times. Once you put the fiber in, you're going to see that increase even more. So, you know, that's pretty much where that is. And again, this all started out as just helping with a couple things, and I started to dig, and it's like, once I dig into things, I've got to fix it, you know? So I fixed it.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the committee?
For who?
No, and like I said, please, everybody understand, this is not a detraction from, you know, what's going on up there. There's a lot of stuff up there that's you know, it's really good. I mean, I agree with Active Directory. It's down the road, that's the way to go.
Can I ask, so basically, do we implement switches and wireless access points?
No, the wireless access points have not been implemented. What I'm doing, or what I've done mostly, is I fixed the switching.
Okay.
Because the thing is, if you don't fix the switching, you plug access points in, you're just extending the network, and you're going to bring it to its knees.
And the switches that you implemented were appropriate for?
They're layer 2, all the switches that, you know, and actually, I haven't done the math lab on 404 right now, and I haven't put the switches with the fiber G-bits down in the CADs because the fiber's not there. But they're all layer 2 smart switches. And basically, when you move to the high school, you can either take them over there and use them in labs, or you can throw them out. It doesn't matter.
Are they PoE switches?
No. I don't have them layered, but there were no PoE devices that I saw.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can put on them, it has a G-bit interface, you can G-bit in another PoE switch on top of it if you want to. And with the network being under 205 meters total, it ain't gonna make a difference. You can put up to, it came out to like 137 PoE devices, but you're not gonna need them, because when I look through the school, you know, you can actually place them in strategic points, because there's only certain places they have wireless. It's not gonna be like a campus. The old school won't be like a campus where you have it everywhere, you know?
Yeah, identifying the ones that were broken or not performing well, that's a big, you know, it's a big job. And it sounds like they did it well.
So that takes care of some of that cost, some of that step in the process, so we're on our way.
It does. And maybe the approach is to continue doing some of the existing wireless access points. It's just those probably won't be transferable to.
Any other questions from the committee?
I've said some questions.
When you say transferable, I think Mr. Necker said that. Isn't the building that already come equipped for everything? So we really don't need to transfer anything, because when the building's being built, it's going to come all with the switches and the access points. And so there's nothing really to transfer. Well, that's what I don't understand.
There is a list of items that are owner provided. Right. I've got a meeting tomorrow with the Ms. Field to go over some of these things and kind of get a project out. Power over Ethernet, wireless access points. We have one over there. They're not provided. We have to provide them. So we have.
And also, the wireless is not provided. There are certain things that the architect doesn't give you in the building. It's your responsibility to select and put in.
And that's what
you want. That's what we're talking about.
Okay.
Now, the issue that was raised is that money available to you earlier than for the building, and can it temporarily be put one place before its final resting in the building? It needs to have its final resting in the building.
Okay.
And we were talking about basically buying it about a year ahead of time.
The other questions I had is, when you say PC versus Macintosh, and you say doing both, is that just because when you did the survey, some of the teachers and some of the staff, some preferred Macintosh, some preferred PC, and is it better, I guess, more cost efficient to just go with, decide with one system, go with one system, and people just have to adapt?
Well, I really think that it has to do with the curriculum. If you decide to go all the way with Mac, and then you have some of your STEM courses that need PC, then...
Or robotics.
Right. You're going to need some PCs.
So it's more curriculum based on the need for the two as opposed to preferences of the staff?
Yes, it's curriculum based.
Okay.
We're not recommending that it be just on preferences. We're saying you should look at what the curriculum.
Okay.
And it could be the curriculum could do either, in which case, you know, that's you choose one or the other.
Do most districts have both, or do they go with one?
Just
system?
About every high school I've run into, whether they admit it or not, have both Macs and PCs. What generally happens is whoever, like it may be an all Mac, but they've got this business course that they really want you to learn on PCs because that's what they're expecting in industry. That's the way the curriculum was set up. So they end up being second class citizens within that school or an art department inside of a normal PC school. They may have it in their art department, but they're second-class citizens. Their accounts aren't managed. You can't get to the files from any place else. So what we're trying to say is it's the infrastructure that should be able to support both. And basically, a small Mac server, you know, maybe a couple thousand dollars is about all need to be able to make the two live in harmony.
So the cost is insignificant, but it gives you more flexibility in regards to curriculum and other use.
Yes.
Would that be fair to say?
Yes. And both platforms, the users of those platforms, are both first-class citizens.
And so that would go with the same thing with the triangular server, in serving both, I guess?
Yeah, it's just a technique that you use so you can manage PCs and Macs from like a single interface.
But still, there are support. I mean, there's training to support and to support people who know PCs and not Macs and vice versa.
So we're trying to, part of the model is to try to get more of a peer support rather than having the tech person. The tech person's got enough to do with the network and the server and kind of all the integration issues and kind of how you use it in your course is really a better done by a teacher.
Yeah, when you say tech person and you recommend hiring an IT position, right now we have an IT department that is shared staff. So, you know, they're taking care of four elementary, one middle school, and one high school, and, you know, it's three individuals. So your recommendation is hire an IT person that is directly serves the high school that way. Do it that way.
And we feel if you do the other support things, probably 95% of the stuff that's needed in the high school could get done.
When you say the other support things, do you mean some of the other recommendations as far as?
Yes. Some of the other things there in terms of the students helping out with some of the tech issues, some of the peer coaching between the teachers as a way of doing it, and having someone else deal with some of the data quality issues. And it's really data quality. It's not so much you need to be an expert in databases or anything like that. Basically get the data right in the system, and there's a standard export that dumps the data out. So you don't need to be a next version of databases.
I just said that one other question. In regards to prioritizing, obviously we have certain budgets that we have to live within. And you, I think you identified a number of different areas. One is the infrastructure, sort of the networking, and I think Mr. Gauthier probably took care of a good chunk of that. The second, you have professional development. The third aspect is regards to the computers, buying the computers themselves to get in the hands of the teachers. And the last is the, not the last, but what I mean, most important is the IT staff. Assuming you can't do all of that in the next couple of years, what would you think is the best benefit in regards to, is it professional development, is it buying the actual computers, is it getting the infrastructure done, or is it getting an IT staff, which would impact the teachers and the students in the best way, I guess, if you can't do all that at once.
I realize that is, I think having someone who is a real expert on the network infrastructure is a key enabler to a lot of the other things that'll make things run smoother. So I'm trying to imagine the list of things right now.
So you say if you hire an IT person, they could help with professional development, so that could cut down that cost, and they could help maybe implement things better so you can cut down some equipment.
And I think also if you go with the with looking at your student system, I think that needs to be done.
Okay.
Even if you end up staying with the existing system, my guess is you're going to discover new ways you can use it to help you out. So I think regardless of what path you go down, that's an important issue.
The job description that you sent us before was like a network specialist. But that network specialist is not a person that's going to be working hands-on with the teachers in the tech integration piece of it.
That's right.
See, I mean, that's a separate individual.
Well, we see that expanded role of your library media person plus peer mentoring, because there are teachers already doing it and doing it well, and they could work with.
Would be the integration piece of it for the time being until we start moving
yes.
the tech department into a bigger department, so to speak.
And we'll probably take a stab at doing this in the tech plan. But there's probably a transition period where you get a new person in, and it'll probably be a merged group for a period of time until things get in place where it could be a separate, dedicated position to the high school.
And I think that setting up this tech committee for the existing building, I think is a really important first step, because as we develop the tech plan, this committee will help guide us and be a sounding board for us. So I would do that right away.
I guess my only concern was that this whole thing started with a request basically by computers for teachers. And then we said, well, before we do that, let's take a look at everything and see where we're going in the right way. And I guess my only concern is if you start hiring, you had $60,000 for IT staff, if you start hiring individuals, then we kind of get away from where we started with getting the hardware and the software in the hands of the teachers to implement that. So that was my only concern in regards to the prioritizing. We started this with getting some computers in the hands of the teachers so they could implement the programs better. I just don't want to get away from that when we start looking at purchasing other things and making sure we go back to where we started.
In a way, my understanding is there's some money identified for that right now.
There is.
We didn't add that on as an extra on here.
Okay.
We're aware of it. So, but we didn't. This would be more of incremental cost over what you're planning now.
No, my only concern is that's on the budget committee. We need to budget things, and we already have this year's budget in place, and there's obviously items in here that you're suggesting you implement in this particular year. So I'm just concerned how we do that within the budget and prioritize it.
Yeah, and again, some of them we may need to revisit. It sounds like the network's going to be in much better shape sooner than we imagined, which is a plus. That puts less pressure on trying to move some of that equipment over here earlier if the network is performing well. So we'll revise the document to reflect that.
Okay.
So, and this is very, very, I mean, the budget, normally we do the budget at the end of the tech, that's part of the tech plan process. This is really preliminary in terms of the numbers. And again, as Steve said, we assumed that the teachers were getting their computers. That was the assumption we made when we put that together.
And that, in a way, you were asking us for a recommendation of whether to do Macs or PCs. And I don't know if we've disappointed everybody or what, but we're basically trying to say it should be a curriculum decision.
Right. No, you explained that very well. Yeah. Thank you.
Can I just make a point? You know, one of the, I had an opportunity to meet with some content teachers last week in terms of the technology integration. And one of the emergent points was this idea of using the current computer labs in the building as model labs for training purposes. And I want to tell you something. I was in a lab today, 2012 HP computers, high speed. That lab today that I was in the library is as good as any university lab that I've been in. That was my assessment when I was in the lab today. And I think that that's the kind of lab that I think we can use for training purposes. I think we can use it for technology integration. I think that's where you can use a multitude of technology components in the short term over the next 2 years to prepare teachers as they shift to the model high school. So I think that that's got a lot of potential in terms of using some of the current labs for training purposes, for professional development, and for technology integration, because I think that in the immediate short term, you're talking about a two-year period, and I think that we certainly want to access some of the current up-to-date labs that we have, and I think that that lab off the library has got a lot of potential as a training forum.
If I may ask, is that all new desktops over there, or?
That was purchased and put in last year.
Last year?
Year before last, at the end of the year.
So it's a 2 year?
So it's a year and like a couple months old.
Year.
It was some computers that were bought at the, not this past school year, but the end of the previous school year. So they're, yeah. So they're like just a year old.
Okay.
They're Windows 7 machines, HP 6000s, all in one units, high def screens, 24.
Are there any questions from the audience?
Yeah, I would just like to just personally thank both Masha and Steve for coming to our building and doing a really nice job listening to the faculty, capturing the voices, using qualitative and qualitative data. I think you did a really nice job with that, taking the time and speaking with faculty. I'm excited about your recommendations. I'm excited about your findings, and certainly I want you to know that we really appreciate the work and the time you put into what you've done. You read through our NEAS report, read through our strategic action plan, you've gone through on state regulations in terms of technology, and I just want to commend both of you for coming here tonight and doing this presentation. I really want to say thank you for that.
So, I think from what has been said, the first step in this process is to appoint a task force. And unfortunately, I don't have a page of the report. But I do have all of the information here on my notepad. So I was going to refer people to the specific page, but there is a suggestion as to who might serve on this task force. I think it's important for us to move ahead on this process and have, obviously, a lot of these very technical issues, at least I'm prepared to acknowledge I know virtually nothing about, and I think it's going to be very helpful to have a balanced group. So if the committee agrees with the recommendation, I think the report presents that the very first step is to develop this task force. I'd like to see us get this in place by our next meeting, and I would invite people who might be interested in serving to make their interests known. The report suggests that obviously there should be representative from the regional school district, such as the superintendent, school administrators, including the principal, the technology director, various curriculum or content coordinators, perhaps a student representative, perhaps a parent representative, a representative from the library and media, the building committee, guidance, special education, community rep perhaps. And that's in the executive summary. These categories are enumerated at page small Roman numeral 5 in the executive summary. So if anyone is interested in serving, if we get a large response, we may not be able to include everyone, but we certainly would like to have a group of people with real technical expertise, as well as people that represent the community and the administration. So are there any other thoughts on this issue?
When I looked at the preliminary draft findings, it seemed like the task force was all, except for one, it seemed to be mostly non-technical people. And I don't know if I read that wrong, or because I only saw the director of technology on there, and otherwise it's just a person. And not that we're reinventing the wheel. We already have a subcommittee, the technology subcommittee I'm on. But of course, we want to do a separate one for, hey, this school. I thought, do you not expand the other committee? Because what we're talking about now is how we do bring in vendors now for such as like the interactive boards to come in now for them to look at that might be going into the new school. So we are kind of involved with the current school as well. Same thing, what can we do now going forward? Is that just, no, we just need a completely separate task force and reinventing the wheel and starting all over again?
Well, we're not going to be starting all over again. There'll be significant overlap between the two committees, assuming that people are willing to serve on both committees. But certainly the director of IT is going to be a member of this group. Hopefully our director of curriculum, the chair of the building committee, technology committee, would be willing to serve on this committee as well, because I think we want to work toward a process where we do as much as we can, as soon as we can, but looking toward being prepared to move into a new high school in 2014. So it will be, I assume, an integrated process, and we will have an overlap, perhaps a significant overlap, as long as people are willing to participate.
Of course.
Yes.
Who would this task force directly report to in terms of reporting back information and progress?
Ultimately to the school committee, I would say. Or to the superintendent. I'm not sure in terms of reporting how that would work, but hopefully we'll have a collaborative process.
And we're also looking for a team of people who will help work with us as we develop the technology plan for both. I mean, this is a 5-year plan. So we'll be working with the new building, technology subcommittee for the new building, but we also need for the next 2 years to have something in place for the current building.
Marcia, in other school districts, do you find task forces such as these helpful when you don't have a robust technology staff in helping with recommendations and to help drive policy and recommendations to the school committees? Because what I would envision with a task force such as this, if you have certain skill sets on that task force and they're working to maintain a 1-3-5-year technology plan, they can help the current staff make recommendations or work with the current staff to make sure that everybody's heard and everyone has a say in technology for the school code.
So I'm not totally clear. So you're talking about your committee, expanding your committee's role?
No, separately, this task force here, the one that you're forming with different people. Their goal is to, obviously, as John mentioned, to see the technology in the new building, but more as a bigger picture, to look at a 1-3-5-year technology plan and manage that process. So, for example, we currently went to Natick. They have a 12-person technology administrative staff, and they're doing a lot of things, and they're exploring different options and policies and whatnot. Does a task force such as this help supplement a smaller staff when it comes to making decisions and recommendations to the school committee, or do you see this as just an individual task force on the technology plan and then the job ends there?
think I maybe I should let you speak.
No, you go ahead.
I was suggesting that this would be something that not only would help form the plan, but would oversee the implementation of it, make sure it's working right. If it's not working the way you wanted it to then make modifications as you go along, so that the group would be responsible for that technology kind of to the end of the building.
And what we would like to see is enough of the end users, because this is all about education. We have a very technical person on the team that, you know, we've recommended. Maybe somebody from the community would be interested in being part of the team. There are teachers who are technical, who are already doing a lot of exciting things. We would certainly welcome people like, I mean, that's recommendations. If you have curriculum coordinators who are doing curriculum technology integration in a great way, you want those people to be on the team. So it's not just the detailed technical information, but really the users. Because really, this is all about teaching the kids. That's the ultimate goal. And making it easier for teachers to teach the kids. The kids to learn and be excited, which is challenging.
So is the process that are you looking for letters of intent, or how are we going to do this, or?
Yes. I don't think we're looking for a formal application, but anyone probably should at least send an email. And if you're not already in a position where your qualifications are obvious, to let us know a little bit about your background and why you'd be interested in serving. Obviously, that is necessary for our IT director, our director of curriculum. We know what their background and skills that they would bring to this process. We know the chair of the building committee's IT committee. We know the roles of principal or content coordinators, but anyone in the community that might be interested whose background might serve the committee well is certainly free to express their intent. We don't want the group to become unwieldy.
But. You know how large? I mean, how many? A dozen people? Eight people? 15
last time. Well, let's look at, see what we get. That probably makes sense.
Can I ask a question? The task force, if I understand this, they get together, are they going to decide how many PCs you buy, how many Macs you buy, and then who do they report to? I think that was a good question. Do they tell the superintendent, okay, buy 50 Macs, buy 50 PCs? Do they report back to the school committee? Who do they, when you make a decision, I guess, what to do? Yeah, what's the process from there? So this task force is going to get together, look at all these recommendations, put them together and say, okay, our first action is let's purchase these many PCs, these many Macs, let's hire an IT person, and then who do they make those recommendations to, and where does it go from there, I guess?
As part of the tech planning process, because this is only the first phase of the project,
okay.
So I see coming out of the tech planning process, these recommendations coming forth and going to the school committee to make decisions. But we won't know how many of each type of, or whether it's one type or both types, until we really start the planning process. We figure out what people are going to be doing.
I guess my question is, I don't want to hold up and purchase. The whole point of this was not to get the computers in the hands of the teachers as quickly as possible. So I see this task force, I see there's a lot of people, you got to organize meetings, everyone's get their schedules together. I can see this going on for a long period of time and nothing's getting done. And we have the money there to purchase the computers. So I'm just trying to wrap my head around how we're going to get this together so we can get the teachers the computers or whatever they need, it fits in the budget and we move it forward.
Well, if you had a good list of goals, hey, this is a timetable. We want to decide Mac, PC, or both by this date, this by this date, and then make the recommendation.
I would say, if I could, I would say probably the first priority for this group is to make some recommendations as to how we get the laptops in the hands of the teachers as quickly as possible. So we know that. And how we implement the training and the professional development that we've also budgeted for the teachers as quickly as possible. And as far as I would anticipate that one or more members of the school committee would also be part of this process and attend these meetings, and no expenditures or changes in line items or increases can occur without the approval of the school committee, nor can a position be added without the approval of the school committee. So as far as that's concerned, I would assume we would have regular reports on the progress of the task force, and any policy decisions or financial decisions would have to be approved by the school committee.
And I think one of the first things that committee does, something very similar, is what are the things we need to decide on, and kind of come up with a schedule to do that. I could see this group also trying to see, are there ways we could better use MMS? You know, get them in there, maybe see some other vendors as well, but, you know, just to see what's available.
So we set a deadline for the people to express their interest?
We meet again on the 13th, okay. And we'd like to have the group in place by then. We have a list of names for the approval of the committee at that point. Yes, Mr.
Question, when would you adopt all these recommendations? Would it have any effect on the overall price of the school? Would it be in addition to the price of the school, $82 million?
No.
That's included?
No.
It doesn't look like it's good. No.
The answer is it had no effect.
That's right.
Thank you.
The budget for the school is already set. What we do is we'll work within that budget.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me just ask you sort of a technical question. Do you expect you're going to change your report?
Not
technology
significantly,
finding,
but we did
recommendations?
We got a few things tonight that we're going to update.
And there are
with.
A few corrections that we've received. So,
because I'd like to have this put up on our website. So once it's finalized,
okay.
And you let us know, and well, obviously, they'll provide us with a final copy.
Yes,
and then,
yes.
PDF format?
Sure.
Yes. Of course.
Please, yeah.
Well, we'll put it in Google Docs.
So.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Turn to our regular agenda. We skipped over matters of public input, so is there any public input at this time?
Mr. Pierce, as you know, a couple of weeks ago, you and I attended the evening school graduation. I'd just like to express my thanks to Mr. Agia for doing another wonderful job, and it was nice to see that we had over 40 graduates school program this year.
There's no other public input. Under old business, item number 4, Bristol County Retirement Assessment Update.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. We have reached an agreement with the town of Somerset through a payroll study by Bristol County Retirement. Assessment to the region for FY12 retirement is going to be $202,394.08.
Can you see that figure?
$202,394.08, which is roughly about $10,000 less than we had anticipated.
FY.
A lot
that something you can anticipate similar to the 13th as well?
I believe so. I don't.
It's based on payroll, which won't fluctuate that much.
Any personnel changes at the high school that would significantly impact that number for 13.
So do we have this item budgeted for 2013?
No, if you recall, we did not budget anything for retirement in 2013. That is the unfunded liability for the current fiscal year.
And we're paying now for $202,394 for 2012.
That's right, well, that fiscal year.
And we have budgeted approximately $10,000 in budget.
Well, we have, you have your original budget, I believe, was something like $275,000. Some of that money was reallocated because we knew the actual assessments were going to be less. We had speculated at about 212, 211, 212, and it came in at 202.
But both of the, am I correct or am I incorrect that both of these payments for 2012 and 2013 are going to have to be paid out of the excess that you reported to us?
Yes, that also, again, see here, we had a surplus of about 10. We did finalize all of the FY12 budget at this point, including closing out all unused POs, encumbrances, etc. The final balance, year end balance for the region for FY12 is 575,465,60.
But does that include the payment of $202,390?
Yes.
Wait, that was budgeted in 2012. We took it out of the 2013.
Yes. It does not include the 13th.
So that five, I'm going to ask it different way, I'm sorry.
Sure.
Is the 575,465 net of the
12 obligation?
The FY12 obligation. It is.
And in terms of, do we have any additional information about the condition of the Bristol County Retirement System and whether they have any unfunded liabilities?
I did not get any additional information on that yet.
Okay. So we're going to request their financial statement for the most recent year and statement of what, if any, unfunded liability they have.
Right, again. Understand, they work on a calendar year, so their most recent fiscal year would be calendar year 2011, so we can wait a couple of months and get 12, or we can go to something that would be essentially two fiscal years behind.
Well, I think it would be good if it's readily available to get a copy of what their latest report is, just so we have a sense of where they stand. Get the newer report once it's available. The next item is summer workshop update.
Mr. Souza had a discussion, I mean the Somerset Board had this discussion last night. I believe the region had already taken action. Mr. Souza, Mr. Machado, just want to comment on the decision of the board last night.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, the Somerset Board is fully on board to do the workshop, and I waited to contact Mr. George until after this meeting and planned on contacting him as the chair of the Somerset Committee to let him know that we're ready to go, and I know the region, we've already taken a vote, and we're ready. Regional side, so I think I think this is the summer workshop has kind of prolonged into a little bit of a fall workshop, but I think it's needed, and we're ready to go.
All right. So, next item is a building committee update. I don't know if you want to report about the. the community meeting?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Been working with the communication subcommittee, and we are meeting, we have planned a meeting for September 24th, which is a Monday evening. It's going to be held at the auditorium at the high school at 7 o'clock. We have a subcommittee meeting planned for this Tuesday at 6 o'clock in the school committee room to go over what we're going to be presenting. What we're looking to do, in a nutshell, is to really kind of go over, you know, what has happened over the past couple of months, what is going to be occurring in the next several months, and keep everybody up to date on, you know, what the neighbors need as well as the community needs for information purposes.
Yes.
Has any communication gone out to parents regarding the routes that is that planned? Regarding the entrance.
Information. I don't believe there's been a one call. I know there's communication that the high school administration stepped out, so I don't have the specifics. I know that's a discussion tomorrow morning at the construction meeting, just to confirm that. I think Dr. Moser is simply waiting for that meeting, and then there'll be some additional information sent out.
All right, and
the only piece, Mr. Pierce, that maybe we're going to bring it up is the fact that we will be having a change on the building committee composition, too, with Mr. O'Neill replacing Mr. Meehan. He was here earlier, but Mr. O'Neill will be joining the building committee. The building committee, I guess, at our next meeting will take formal action as it relates to that. Typically, that has been the position, which is they take that action, and we submit that information to the MSBA for the update.
I would simply like to mention that there have been some articles in the press recently which I think have raised perhaps some concerns, and I'd like to address them briefly. I also serve as a member of the building committee, and I have attended every Friday morning job meeting with the exception of one since the project began, and I am very comfortable with the way the project is progressing. It is absolutely true that there have been some issues, but the fact is that on a project of this magnitude, we are going to encounter issues from time to time. And when we do, our project manager, our architect, and the members of the building committee who have also been attending these weekly job meetings with me will be sure that the interests of the taxpayers of Somerset are very carefully protected, and that any problems that exist will be addressed. By way of example, the issue of Grandview Avenue, which is a public street. It is about 200 feet long west of County Street. It serves only the high school. The plans have for months, if not longer, indicated that road would be disturbed for installation of a new water main, and that it would be slightly relocated. A permit was obtained to open the road. The process was not followed to relocate the road, which in my view is a procedural issue rather than a substantive issue, which will be addressed with the Board of Selectmen and perhaps ultimately with the town meeting. But it is not an issue that impacts in any way in terms of abutting property owners or general access on a public street in town. There have been some issues with runoff from the site, which occurred principally during what was essentially a flash flood, and oddly something that was anticipated, although it is expected that the site subcontractor will be prepared and will have adequately protected the site to see to it that that kind of runoff doesn't occur, even in the instance of what was probably a 100-year type of event. But I want the people of Somerset to be assured that the people on the building committee, including the representatives from this committee, are very much aware of these issues, very concerned about them, and are doing everything that we possibly can to assure that the project is run in a professional way and that the interests of the community are protected. So we'll continue to do that, and I don't want people, I think that some of the reporting in the press has significantly exaggerated the conditions that have existed there, and I'm really, while concerned about some of these issues that have occurred, I'm very confident about the way the project is progressing. We have a tight time frame within which to complete this building. The general contractor is expected to turn the building over to us in June of 2014 so that we have the summer to move into the building, and a delay in that process would be very significant, both in terms of the education of our kids and possible additional expense that could be incurred if we had to delay move into the building until sometime after the beginning of the school year. So we're going to continue to move the project ahead in an expeditious way, while at the same time assuring that all the I's are dotted and all the T's are crossed. I don't know if anyone else has anything on that issue.
The only thing I'd like to add too is that I think you described it well as procedural problems, and I think you got to keep the sort of the eye on the major ball is any delays that result not only increase the cost, but you got to look at the interest rates as well. When you go out to bond now, it's a great time to do that. So the procedural issues can be addressed, but you don't want those procedural issues to undermine and result in delays, because then you're not looking out for the taxpayers of Somerset and Berkeley. You're actually undermining that because you're creating more costs, which costs the taxpayers money. So you want to make sure everything's done properly, but you don't want to get caught down on procedural issues that slow it down, because that will really cost the taxpayers of Somerset and Berkeley significant costs with interest rates and delays.
And just let me add one other thing. Both Mr. Fenstermaker and I attended the Board of Selectmen's meeting last week, and we explained these issues to the Board of Selectmen, and I felt that we came away from that meeting with a clear understanding, a mutual understanding as to how we would work together to resolve these issues. And some of the press that we've received in the last week or so, I don't think has reported at all on the discussions that occurred at the meeting, and I think the cooperative attitude that was expressed by the Board of Selectmen and by myself on behalf of this committee and Mr. Fenstermaker on behalf of the building committee. So I'm still feel very comfortable with the relationship between our boards, the building committee and the school committee and the Board of Selectmen. And we'll continue to work cooperatively and respect their needs and recognize that we have responsibilities to the community that we have to fulfill. So if we can now turn to budget transfer requests.
Not at this time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Approval of July requisitions for the high school buildings project. I believe because our meeting in mid-August was canceled, we circulated that warrant, and it's been signed by an adequate number of members of the committee so that it could be paid. Next item is review policy news from the Massachusetts Association of School Committees. did receive a policy news update from the Massachusetts Association of School Committees with several recommended changes to various policies. I think that we should talk about perhaps a process to review not only these recommended changes. There are some others that we have talked about that I believe, at least, that we need to address. I don't believe that the information from the Massachusetts Association of School Committees deals with the possibility of us being able to attend regional school committee meetings remotely, and I think that's something that we should discuss at a future meeting and consider whether we would be interested in adopting that provision of the open meeting law, which would allow a member of the committee who perhaps was out of town or not able to leave home for some reason, that it's not a situation where, according to the change in the open meeting law, you can simply decide to sit at home rather than come to the meeting if you're physically capable of doing so. But there are certain circumstances under which you'd be able to attend the meeting remotely, and I think we should consider that change. I think there are some other areas of policy that have occurred to me. For example, I think we should think about a social media policy. We should consider a written policy about accommodating religious beliefs of students and faculty. And I believe there was one other. We also have, I believe at Mr. Kelly's request, in the packet of material for this meeting, copies of our public complaint policies and our fundraising policy. So, no, if anyone has any suggestion as to how we might go about approaching a review of these policies, my own sense is it might be beneficial to have a smaller group than the entire committee review these and make recommendations and perhaps do a little research as to what policies might be in surrounding communities or whether there are model policies available from the school committee association or the superintendent's association.
Do we have a committee like that we just disbanded this year?
Yeah, we would need, yes, when we did the initial review, Mr. Pierce, Mrs. Gaylor, if I may add, you did have two representatives. I was part of that group, and we sat down and did the entire piece. You actually have two different areas here, specifically the policies you referenced. I think you have four or five where MASC, which we've adopted these policies, have made some minor changes that could easily be adopted in the second reading and voted on. And then you have some of the other issues where you're just showing existing policies where you have some questions where a group would want to research. I certainly could work with two board members in doing that. We had that discussion back and forth. The Somerset Board and Group of Five, K-8 has chosen to bring the policies to the entire board as opposed to a subcommittee, just to prevent that layer. So you have that option as well. Some of these MASC, as you see here, are pretty straightforward. They've added a couple of gender identity, for example, a couple of pieces, school emergency plan, and there'll be some additional pieces, so you could have to put them on for a second reading and have the entire board, or you simply could have the subcommittee meet, make recommendations, and then take all of those votes and actions, and it certainly would address that research issue where you want to get some comparable pieces. The policies, for example, under public complaints and fundraising reflect for neighboring communities that typically mirror the MASC policy, so we'd have to do a little diggy if we wanted to make some modifications to that or address specific concerns here, but I certainly could work with two individuals if that was the case, or we could we
could have it on the agenda and in more detail have a second reading. We typically have had a second reading where action is taken on a policy, especially where there's even if there's a minor change to it. It gives people an opportunity to get some feedback, and the idea that the MASC put out is a nice way to see it, which is you make sure that it's in some different form so you can see what the change is. So they do that. Desire of the board.
I just remembered the third area that I thought we might look at is the issue of field trips, particularly overnight field trips. I think our policy is rather Spartan when it comes to that issue, and I thought we might look at that also, see if we could find other model policy, perhaps, or policies from other school districts that had a little more detail as to how we would handle particularly overnight kinds of field trips that occur from time to time.
Typically, school boards have it as a standing agenda item policy review. It may be at various levels, and I would encourage this board to continue to maintain that. It's just a matter of how you want to get to that final step in the process here.
The other comment I had, I don't know if you call it a policy or a procedure that the school committee has working amongst ourselves. For instance, and maybe this workshop will actually help me out a lot on this, is we had a complaint one time by Mr. Wilson from Berkeley regarding some athletics, and we said that we're going to refer it back down, but then I never hear back what happened. And sometimes I see complaints and they interest me, and maybe I want to do something broader with it, but we have a complaint policy, so we send it back down, but then I never know what happened with it. So I don't know if it was addressed properly, whether that issue's been resolved, whether it's not been resolved. So I don't know what our internal policies are, procedures are in regards to, we have these complaints, we have these policies, but then I never know what happened to them. And the one that Mr. Wilson brought up has been brought up to me, not by Mr. Wilson, but many, many times by other parents as well. So it's an overlying thing that I think needs to be addressed at some point, but I don't know policy or procedure-wise how we do that. Do we direct it to the superintendent? Do we get the athletic director in here? And how do we do it, a particular complaint, or do we have a policy and agenda ourselves?
So I think this
speaks to that.
The material that the superintendent provided to us on public complaints is several pages, and it deals with complaints related to various types of complaints, including complaints directed at a particular member of the faculty or administration. And I thought that Mr. Wilson's complaint was addressed and that he was satisfied with the resolution.
But I don't know if I would be satisfied. That's my point, is I don't know what the resolution was. I don't think we ever got a formal thing back what happened, and he may have been satisfied himself, but I may have not been satisfied with the result, and I may want to pursue that further in regards to more of an investigation of what's going on with it. So I don't know if we have policies, procedures in place for that. I mean, an individual parent maybe satisfied with the result, but maybe there's a broader, big issue that needs to be addressed, not just that one complaint. So I guess my thing is, what happened with that, how it was addressed, and more of a formal way of looking at it and reporting back to us as to what happened with that particular complaint. Because again, that parent may drop it, but maybe there's a bigger issue that needs to be addressed by us.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Could we have the superintendent just report, maybe send something? Because A, I don't know what the complaint is about because I wasn't on the nor Mr. Patrick. So one, maybe if we can get a copy of that complaint, and two, since Mr. Kelly would like to know how it was handled and how it was handled, basically. We can then look at it and just keep it to our notes, and if there are any further discussion, then Mr. Kelly or any other member could contact the superintendent or the building principal and address his or her concerns.
All right. Why don't we provide the members of the committee with a brief, confidential summary of that complaint, and then if anyone feels that it's necessary to discuss either a principal involved or the situation, we can make a determination as to how it should be how it should be approached.
At the time, I mean, it's a little dated now. Mr. Kelly's correct. It was in the springtime. It was addressed. I did report back to the committee. I would agree there needs to be some way. I think really in this instance, or at least in this specific example, the report back, I think the board had issue with maybe the ultimate outcome, not necessarily the reporting back, but because there's a mechanism clearly in place that you need, I need to report back or some designee for me to let you know that a complaint was issued and here was the finding, whatever it may be, some of which may be personnel matters. I don't have a problem with making sure the board's informed. I mean, I think it's a little dated now to go back to something that was 6 months ago, but moving forward as we get to the year, I clearly, if we get a complaint, I certainly feel a responsibility and feel the board should at least be made aware that one, the issue was addressed, how it was addressed, as best we confidentially can do so, and address it. So, I mean, I actually think our policy is actually okay. We're just going to be sure that, make sure that it does speak to making sure that you're informed about what decisions were in there. It says a complaint which is presented to the committee and referred back to the proper chance adjusted before it comes back, a report of the disposition of the matter will be made to the committee. I mean, so it's clear that you need to know that in fact the complaint was made at your level, was bounced back to wherever it was, and then you should get receive something, which I can assure will take place as we move into this next school year moving forward. I mean, I don't have an issue with obviously a policy group looking to change the current policy, but I do think it addresses that specific concern. That's the prerogative of the board.
I recall in that specific instance that the parent and student came to a school committee meeting, had an opportunity to present the complaint. I believe, I know that it was addressed by the principal and the superintendent, and I thought, but my recollection may not be correct, that the result was reported to the committee.
But moving forward, I can be sure that takes place and involves the necessary school personnel. I mean, most likely it's going to be a site-based individual, whether it be a department head or athletic director if it's a coaching issue. But I can be sure that moving forward, that if the complaint is raised, that you would confidently give a report back as to what that is.
But in this instance, Mr. Kelly, are you satisfied with the information that was provided to you, or do you feel you need some additional information?
I don't know what formal report was made, I guess. I mean, I've spoken to Mr. Medeiros about that, just because I picked up the phone and called him. But I don't know if a formal report was made back to the school committee in regards to that. And then procedure and policy wise, like I said, it's beyond Mr. Wilson. I don't know how you do this with complaints. I've heard a number of complaints similar from other parents who have come up to me since then. To me, it's an ongoing issue, and I don't know how to address it. I guess that's why I'd like some procedures and policies in place with us, is if maybe some parents complain to you personally and you have an issue with it, how we formally adopt that into a complaint. If it's sort of an informal thing, but it catches your attention.
In the incident that you're referring to, there was a specific complaint from a specific parent, which was investigated and addressed. If some kind of overarching issue has been presented to you by various people, then I would suggest that you raise the issue with the superintendent, either directly with him or and then ask him to investigate, at which point he will then report back and to the committee on what the specific situation is. If it involves a particular individual, then there may be some safeguards involved that we'll have to recognize and deal with. But if it's a more general situation, like the Somerset players are being denied, generally being denied playing time or something like that, that's a kind of a general complaint, I'll ask the superintendent to look into it and report back to us.
Well, I guess that's my question is, do individual members, do we want individual members directing the superintendent to conduct investigations, or do we first want to come to the school committee, and the school committee says, well, no, I don't think that's something that's warranted an investigation? I guess that's my question is, do we want individual members directing investigations of the superintendent when the rest of the members may not think that it's an investigation that's warranted and wasting the time of the school? I guess that's my more concern of when do we raise that. Each school committee does it on themselves, or do it as a committee?
My take, George, is that if there's any kind of complaint, whether it's from a parent or from a student or a personnel or even a school committee member, I think it needs to be addressed immediately. The superintendent needs to be contacted. If both of you then feel it's warranted, then to bring to the school committee, because it might be even a larger issue, then that's when it would be brought to the school committee. But I think the superintendent would look at. I would expect him to look into that complaint immediately and find out what is going on, and then report right back to you, or to whoever complained, with that complaint. But after that fact is then bring it back to the school committee. The Somerset KA just had an incident with a parent complaining about air quality here at North. I got the phone call within less than an hour. I was talking to the superintendent. An hour later, he was already on the phone, scheduling something with DPH to come and do an air quality test. And then we reported what the findings were, to the entire committee. That's a procedure that's, been done, I think, regularly. I think any complaint needs to be addressed immediately, because we might not have a school committee meeting for 2 to 3 weeks. So, that complaint could linger, and then something else could occur. So I think addressing it immediately would be the best way to do it. That's just my take.
I think that retreat will have, I'm hoping that helps us formalize this.
I think the policy also, and the superintendent has suggested this in some of the prior situations, it's really not so significant where the complaint is lodged, but the fact is the complaint should go first to the person who's most directly involved, and it may very well be the principal who's asked to address it in the first instance, and then report to the superintendent, who determines whether that response has been adequate, but then should make the committee aware of what the situation was and how it was addressed.
We have 3,000, close to 3,000 students in the 6 schools. It's routine, certainly my assistant can attest to that, that I get a phone call because a parent doesn't know where to go with an issue at a school. I direct them back to the principal, who ultimately may direct them back to a coach and or a teacher. I ultimately don't necessarily get the written report. Some of my predecessors used to require that. I know because I was a building principal for 11 years in the district. In some instances, it's significant enough where you do want that piece. But in most instances, my response or my assistant's response is, and if you are not satisfied with the result of the contact that you receive, please refer it back to my level. Likewise, I think that's a similar fashion, which is if you directed something back to me and someone says they're still not satisfied or you want some information, I think you let me know that. We'll take the necessary action.
So, do we have anyone who's interested in serving on a policy committee? All right, so I will appoint a policy subcommittee for our next meeting.
Mr. Chair, are we acting on any of these today? When I received it a couple of meetings ago.
The old ones. Yeah, I know you refer to the emergency plans.
No, not the emergency plans, but the BEC regarding executive sessions. In red, it states that the school committee chair and the superintendent will review the executive sessions, our executive session minutes. I think we should change that to the school committee will appoint 2 members, and along with the superintendent will review the executive session minutes. That was what we had decided, unless the chairman would like to take over that responsibility. I would second that.
Oh, you volunteered, Victor.
So that being a first reading, you're in the second reading, you'd make that adjustment and you could take that.
Right. And I believe I looked at the statute before we did that, and the statute merely requires that there be a periodic review, so I think it's perfectly appropriate for us to do something other than have the superintendent and the chair do that. So I think what we propose is probably fine, but I'll look at that between now and the next meeting, and then we can act on it. The next and
Mr. Pierce, if I just may add before we move on to that, what I would suggest, if you're okay with the agenda, is to have them listed by policy just for future agenda items so you can see them. I know some of them are kind of captured in that policy news, but actually list each policy and where they stand. That way, if it's an action item, it's a second reading, you can take that. If it's a review, you know that. So I'm going to make that modification for future meetings.
Fine.
Thanks.
Discuss scheduling a joint meeting with the Somerset School Committee. And I believe the primary purpose of that meeting is to discuss the superintendent's compensation, which we unfortunately have deferred a couple of times and is yet to be resolved. And the Somerset School Committee is meeting again next week, September 6th.
We have a scheduled meeting for September 6th, but as we discussed last night, there's no reason for us to have a back-to-back meeting on the Somerset K-8 side. So we could have just in that meeting that night just entirely for a joint meeting. So we don't have any time constraints that we've run into when we've had the past couple of joint meetings for executive sessions.
So you're saying that you don't need to have that September
6th
meeting?
We discussed we're not going to have a K-8, but we're holding that date. All the members are holding that date for a possible joint meeting. So it's up to the pleasure of the board here.
So I think we need to get that issue resolved, and I would suggest that we meet with the Somerset Committee next Thursday.
There are a few items that we needed to get to discuss.
There was also actually the technology person, if it was going to be a shared position or not, because the K-8 is actually ready to move on a possible technology person.
So we put that item on the agenda as well.
So that's at 6:30 next Thursday, September 6th.
There'll also be a subcommittee meeting at the goals group at 5:30.
On September 6th.
On September 6th, that meets. I know we just sent that out. We had to make an adjustment today. I think Mrs. Gagliardi and for that piece, Mr. Camara, Mrs. Correa, and Ms. White. So that is at least our intent at this point, if it's confirmed, that we'll post a meeting at 5:30 for the goals. And then subsequently, with the agenda is created by the chairs for the joint.
Okay, so the last item on the agenda is an executive session. In accordance with Chapter 30A, Section 21, for the purpose of discussing negotiation update with the STA regarding teacher evaluation, because an open session would have a detrimental effect on the board's negotiating position.
So moved.
No open sessions to follow.
I apologize. So moved.
Motion made by Mr. Souza, seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Any discussion?
Mr. Chair, should we mention that our next regular scheduled meeting will be September 13th?
Our next regularly scheduled meeting will be September 13th, 2012. If there's no discussion, roll call, Mrs. Gagliardi.
Aye.
Mr. Souza.
Aye.
Mr. Machado.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Mr. Patrick.
Aye.
Chair votes aye.